Last time, we looked at how to solve systems of linear equations in two variables using techniques from pre-calculus called substitution and combination. In this lesson, we're going to look at a more systematic approach to solving systems of linear equations in general. Last time, we talked about the definition of systems of linear equations in n unknowns. So this, written below, is a more general picture of what a system of linear equations could be represented as. So if you look, in this example, we have m different equations, where m can be as many as we want in whatever system comes up, and we have our n unknowns, x1, x2, through xn. Remember that all of our aij's, which now, because we have m different equations, each of which have technically n plus 1 constants, we're using aij to mean the I represents what equation we're looking at, and the j is which variable we're multiplying that constant by. Today, we're going to look at a more compact form that we can use to represent our system of linear equations and its constants. Today we're going to work through solving this system of linear equations. If you look, again we have three variables, which we're going to call x1, x2, and x3. So our goal is to find a solution vector, which we'll call s1, s2, and s3, that satisfies simultaneously all three of these linear equations. Our first step in giving a better representation of this linear system in a way that will make it easy for us to solve is we pull out all of our coefficients. So these are all of the constants that we're multiplying our unknowns by, and we place them inside what we're going to call the coefficient matrix of our system. So in our very first equation, let me pull out a little arrow so we can see this. In our first equation, we see that x1 has coefficient 3, x2 has coefficient negative 4, and x3 has coefficient 1. So that's represented by the row 3, negative 4, 1 in our coefficient matrix. For equation 2, we see that x1 has coefficient 2. x2 isn't present in this system, so we put a 0 in that slot, and our coefficient of x3 is negative 5, so our second row of our coefficient matrix will be 2, 0, negative 5. And finally, our third row, which corresponds to our third equation, should have coefficients negative 6, positive 5, and negative 3. When we refer to matrices, all we mean is rectangular arrays that are going to contain entries where each of our entries is a constant from whatever field we're working over. So in addition to the coefficient matrix, something that you guys might have thought about while we filled out our coefficient matrix was we weren't really keeping track of all of the constants appearing in our linear equations. So the way we keep track of our constants is a matrix with one additional column, where this column corresponds to all of the coefficients on the right-hand side of our system of linear equations. So we're going to today look at using these matrices to efficiently solve linear systems in a systematic way, making it easy for us to keep track of our work. Our basic goal is to take one system of linear equations and replace it with one that's easier to solve. At each stage in the algorithm we're about to walk through, we're going to take a system of linear equations and replace it with one that has ever so slightly easier for us to read off solutions until our final linear system, which will be equivalent to the first, will contain exactly what the values of x1, x2, and x3 would have to be to satisfy all three of the equations we began with. So to make this strategy a little clearer for us to work with, on the left-hand side of every slide, you're going to see the equations just written out as is. On the right-hand side, we'll keep track of the matrix notation, and you'll be able to see how each of the steps that we take, what it looks like on the left, directly in equation form, and what it looks like on the right as we change our matrices to keep track of what we're going to call elementary row operations. So looking at our coefficients, we're going to start in step one by examining the coefficient of x1 in the very first equation. So in our matrix, that's this 3 here, and in our equation, that was 3x1 in the upper left-hand corner. So our first step is, after we've examined that coefficient, we're going to divide every term in equation 1, including that first term, by, in this case, 3. So in the top, you can see our original system of equations, and on the bottom, you can see the terms that we get after we divide every coefficient of each of the variables and our constant by our 3. On the right, that's a little maybe easier for us to keep track of, in that we just took every entry in this row and divided it by 3. And if you look carefully, you'll notice, or you might have wondered, what happens if x1 is 0? The only change that we'll make is, if x1 is 0, we will swap that row with whatever the next equation is where the coefficient of x1 isn't 0, and then repeat the algorithm from there. So once we have our array on the right-hand side here with a 1 where our x1 was, we'll move on to the next step. For our second step, now that we've simplified our equation so that it has a constant in front of x1, it's just 1, what we're going to do is subtract as many copies as we need to of equation 1 from the other two equations in our system. So from our second equation, since our coefficient is 2, we know that we're going to have to subtract from equation 2, 2 copies of equation 1. And looking at our third equation, we see that we have a negative 6, so we're going to replace our third equation with equation 3 plus 6 copies of equation 1. And again, our goal here is to remove all copies of x1 from our system of linear equations, except in our very first term. So on the right, it's a little more compact way of representing it. We see we want to subtract the row, starting with a 1, we'll subtract from row 2, we'll subtract 2 copies of row 1, and from row 3, we'll add 6 copies of row 1. And examining down on the bottom of the screen, you can see that I've already done these steps for you guys for this system of equations. So the algebra can get a little, the algebra is fairly basic. The arithmetic can be a little tedious, so be careful while you're working through systems of linear equations that you check your work. So again, one of our goals, in fact, our primary goal, was to have a new system where the only equation that contains any copies of x1 is our very first one. The basic idea, again, is trying to eliminate copies of a variable from all but one equation. So we're going to repeat for the rest of our steps. They're going to have us removing copies of A2 from every part of the equation except from equation 2, and removing all terms containing x3 from all of the equations except for the third one. So let's move on and look at what happens when. So for step three, again, we're essentially repeating our earlier actions with x1. We're looking at our coefficients in the second equation for x2, and we're going to divide our entire row 2 by whatever we have to make our coefficient in front of x2, 1. So we're going to replace the second row with 3/8 times itself. So looking through, I can see that after multiplying every entry in the row by 3/8, we have on our matrix side the row 0, 1, negative 17/8, and negative 1/8. And back on our equation side, we see that we get x2 minus 17/8, x3 is equal to negative 1/8. Hopefully you folks can see the advantages of the matrix notation. While it still requires us to do all of the same arithmetic, it's a little more compact and easier for us to quickly see exactly what we have to cancel out. Now that we've gone through and rescaled our second equation, so our constant in front of x2 is 1, we're going to subtract as many copies of row 2 as we need to from rows 1 and 3 so that we can eliminate our coefficients in front of x2 in those equations. So from row 1, we're going to replace it with 4/3 row 2. And for row 3, we're going to replace it with row 3 minus 3 copies of row 2. And in the bottom, you should be able to see the somewhat, messy coefficients that we get. But at this point, we've gotten our matrix so that in the first two columns, there's exactly one copy of x1 and one copy of x2. All right, and now we're into the home stretch. For our third equation, we notice that both sides are negative 59/8. So again, our goal is to have as our coefficient in front of x3, to turn that into 1. So we're going to multiply both sides by 8/59, negative 8/59, and we get the equation x3 is equal to 1, which corresponds to this row, 0, 0, 1, 1. So one of the nice things, as I mentioned, we're in the home stretch, is we actually know that our solution to the system of linear equations already has to have our third unknown, has to have value 1. So let's look at, we're in the final step. Now that we've got x3 is equal to 1, we can subtract off copies of row 3 from our other two rows to get x1 and x2's values alone as well. So from x2 and x1, we see that we're going to have to add 5/2 of x3 to cancel out our value of x3 up there. So we take row 1, and we're going to add 5/2 times row 3. And to row 2, we're going to add 17/8 times row 3. And after we complete that, we see that our system of linear equations becomes x1 is equal to 3, x2 is equal to 2, and x3 is equal to 1. So again, our goal with this was to take our original system of linear equations, which in this case was not so easy for us to see what our values x1, x2, and x3 should be if we wanted to satisfy all three of those equations simultaneously. After 6 steps, carefully rewriting our system of linear equations to get x1, x2, and x3 alone, we're able to see that our solution vector should look like 3, 2, 1. So I'll leave it up to you guys to check on your own. Feel free to pause this video and work through it. Plug in x1 is equal to 3, x2 is equal to 2, and x3 is equal to 1, and verify that this solution actually does simultaneously make all three of those equations true. So in general, all of these moves that we made, so there were only 6 steps in this particular example that we had to take, each of these moves actually falls into one of 3 distinct types. And so these are all called elementary row operations. So the first one that we did to sort of get this started is we started with multiplying all of the entries in a row by a non-zero constant. So this was essentially taking our first row and rescaling it so that the coefficient in front of x1 became 1. So once we'd scaled a row appropriately, we would then go through and attempt to cancel out copies of that unknown from all of our other equations by using the replacement operation. And although we didn't actually have to do it in this example, there are times when if you don't have a copy of the variable you need next, you'll have to interchange a pair of rows to get the variable that you want to get alone. So while elementary row operations are, they're going to be the core of our strategy for solving systems of linear equations, for the second half of our first class, we're going to spend a lot of time learning how to make a computer do these for us. So I will see you guys next time. And from here, we're going to move on to look at other types of matrix operations we can use to solve systems of linear equations.